talks about, there's different versions, and that's one reason I like, like my iPhone, because I can pull up different things, the different versions. But Psalm 22:3, in the King James it says, "But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel." I love that. And I was thinking about, you know, inhabited. And one of the things about that is inhabit or enthrone means to judge in an ambush. It's like when we praise God, he will set himself right in the middle of our lives. Isn't that powerful? Yes. We inhabit our praises. When we praise him, he comes and he sits right in the middle of everything that's going on. I think that is so powerful. In the middle of our lives and judge the enemies that surround us. And the Japanese translation says, when you praise God, he brings a big chair and sits there. You know, I love that. I love that. He brings a chair and just sits in the middle of what's going on. In Exodus, this was so powerful. When God is talking to Moses in the burning bush, and we go down here in verse 6. I'll go ahead and start in verse 5. And we know the story of that. And God said, "Do not come near." He's talking to Moses. "Put your shoes off your feet, for the place in which you stand is holy ground." Yes. It's always holy ground when God's there. It's always holy ground because we serve a holy God.
Yes.
And he says, also he said, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob." And yes. Moses hid his face, for he is afraid to look on God. This is what really is so powerful to me. Again, inhabits our praises. He's sitting in the midst. God's aware of what we got going on in your life. Sometimes we think, because we're involved, and you know, we think that God has kind of left the room and he's not there. But the Bible doesn't say that. It says right here that God is with us. And he's saying, the Lord said, "I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters and oppressors. For I know," I love that. That's what he said. He knows. He's aware. "For I know their sorrows and sufferings and trials." That is so powerful. God's aware of what's going on. Nothing escapes him. And he said, "I have come down to deliver them out of the hand and power of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land to a land good and large, a land flowing with milk and honey, a land of plenty, to the place of the Canaanite, Hebrite, Hittite, Amorite, Perizzite, Hivite, and Jebusite." What I love about this, "for I know."
Yeah.
Again, we go back, inhabit the praises. It's like you bring God right down in the midst of this. Yeah. And I'm here to tell you today that God is good. God is aware. God has not forgotten you. It doesn't matter how far you've been away. Some people say, you know, "Oh, Tim, man, I don't know. I got too far away from the Lord." How are you going to do that? How are you going to do that? The Bible says, "To make my bed in hell, there's you're there." Yeah. And I always say, if people make their bed, they're planning on coming back.
Right.
You know? So I'm saying, if you come back, he's still there.
Yeah.
Okay? That's what I love about God, because he don't give up. You know, you don't give up. I know sometimes I say the same things, because the same things still mean things.
Yeah.
And the thing is, you don't give up on your kids.
Right.
You know, if they fail you once, you say, "Oh, you're done. It's time." No, you bear with them because you love them.
Right.
I don't know anybody that doesn't want their kids to do well.
Right.
They want all their kids to do well. You know, when people ask you, and you can tell when you're getting older, because when they ask you as kids, you pull out all the pictures. Now you got them on your iPhone. You know, you can put 1,000 pictures. You want to see my grandkids? And that's what I love about Facebook, because they're always putting pictures, and I can just download them. But you can see them grow. You can see that sparkle in your face.
Yeah.
And you know what? You know, we're so proud to show off your kids. Well, God wants to show you off. See, one thing that people have trouble with is we tell them God loves them. I've told people that. God loves you and he cares about you. You know what? And I said, me? God cares about me? Yes, he cares about you. I had a student in the class, and one thing about it, he's telling me so many times that he's had miracles happen in his life that he's still alive. And I said, about every day he's got something new to share, a close shave. You know, he's sharing all this stuff. And I said, God's got angels out, man. He got an angel watch. So finally shook his head, yeah. I said, tell you what, you know, God's got angels. God's got circumstances around us. Because I'm telling you, as dealing with driving a lot, I know a second here, a second there can make a world of difference. And all that hurt that you're going through, all the frustration, God said, hey, hang on. You know, hang on. Because when Jesus said, we're going to make it to the other side, brother, I'm telling you, you're going to make it to the other side. Let me tell you.
Yeah.
You know, if Jesus piled the ship, we're going to get there. I tell you what, and that's what we always got to look like. That's the one thing that God is just putting on my heart more and more and more is how much he loves every single one of you.
Yes.
And all he wants, it's like sometimes you see that you feel the cry of God's heart. God always loved people that was willing to go through him, was willing to press on through the crowd to touch him. Uh-huh. You know, and we think about the woman with the issue. She's going to press through the crowd. You know, that's, hey, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I know I can be made whole. And you got all these people pushing, you know, pushing through the crowd. So I'm going to do it. And it comes down to our will, our choice. And it's if we just started to push through. You know, the blind man, he heard, you know, the commotion. What's going on here? You know, it's Jesus there. And you know, he start crying out, Jesus. He start crying out, Son of David, you know, start crying out. So, shh, you know, the crowd. No, you're going to disturb him. Well, I tell you what, I'm going to disturb him. That's what's going to happen. You know? And I mean, he kept making noise. And Jesus turned around, bring him here. Well, and it's interesting. I heard that today. It's interesting. The blind man, you know, deep inside what he wanted, right? He wanted to see. But Jesus asked him, what do you want me to do for you? Isn't that interesting?
Yep.
When you know what it was, and sometimes we just need to ask God. Mm-hmm. We just need to go out and ask God. And it's just like a kid asking, what do you want? It's like taking him to a toy store. You got all his toys, and he might have been, for years, might have been desiring one particular thing.
Yeah.
Just ask him. Because I, you know, we look at Jesus and he knows all things, but sometimes it's just that, what do you want? Because you know what? I want to do the right thing for my child.
Mm-hmm.
The right thing. And that's what I feel God wants to do. Because some of you, it's just like, I know there's things in your life you've been crying out for a long time. God says, what do you want me to do?
There you go.
What do you want me to do for you? I love that. Because I always get amazed at the creation of God. I'm always amazed at the creation of God that he'd done all this and just spoke it.
Yep.
You know, and if you look at Genesis, he said, this was good, this was good, this was good. But you know when it came to man, mm-hmm. it was very good. You ever notice that?
Yeah.
It was very good. It wasn't just good. It was very good. Because now God's got a companion. Can you imagine God walking in the cool of the day? I mean, that to me is awesome. The Creator created all and walking in the cool of the day. How you doing there, Adam? How's things going today? You know? Eve, how's things going? God, they're just going fine. You know? Can you imagine every day? And we can do that. We can do that. They got restored that we can walk, we can go right in, and we can have that fellowship with God. And that's what he's really longing. You know, sometimes, you know, everybody can pray different times of the day, but there's something about doing it the first thing in the morning. You know, everything's still, everything's so quiet. You know, the day hadn't got started yet. There's something about taking those few minutes and saying, God, you know what? I just want to tell you this morning, I love you.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what you have in store for me today, God, but I'm already going to praise you for
it. Come on.
Good or bad, I'm still going to serve you.
Yeah.
Good or bad, whatever may come this day, I know that you're working all things together for the good, those that love God. No matter what happens, you're going to bring good out of it.
Yes.
And that's what I feel God wants us to do.
Yeah.
It's praise him, inhabit the praises. It just brings him right down to where we live. Hallelujah.
Glory.
Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Well, we're going to open this praise time up to praise God. Because that's where the changes happen,
mm-hmm.
when we start praising God.
Yes.
Sometimes we make our problems so big, and then we forget one thing. We forget how big God is.
Mm-hmm.
There ain't nothing bigger than him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and he can handle whatever gets thrown at him.
Yes, yes.
You know, I love how the young people say, I got this. Well, God's saying tonight, I got this. Hallelujah. So we're going to open this up right now. Anybody like to praise God? Yes, Myron.
As some of you know, I've been through a situation this past weekend, and I have an ulcer on my right leg. And I was in so much pain this weekend. And it seems like things happen on the weekend, you know, when everything's closed. But anyways, I was like, got to the point where I was just and my leg just felt like it was sitting on a fireplace, burning. And so anyways, I got there, they gave me a shot, pain went away, and they started to fix me up and sent me home. When I got home, they gave me some meds, some pain medication. And when I got home, I turned off the light and I went to go to sleep, and I looked, and I don't know, but I could see a picture. It seemed like it was a picture of Jesus with the crown of thorns.
Oh, hallelujah.
And I could see his face, and it just was like, Lord, I know how much pain that you have gone through for me.
Hallelujah.
You know, and I can endure this. I can get through this. But I gotta admit, it was so hard to see. You know, I just felt my heart, you know, praising me, that I'm in so much pain.
Yeah.
You know, and he takes care of it. So I'm doing well now, and gonna get some tests for arterial flow, the blood flow to my leg. The doctor was saying that he thinks, you know, that it may be stopping the healing. Well, I prayed about that already, and there's no blockage there.
Thank you, Lord.
So I'm going with that.
I
got an appointment on Thursday, so I'm just, yeah, exactly. Because it didn't say in the word that, you know, test me and see,
mm-hmm.
you know, and tell the people that testimony,
yep.
what I've done.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Glory.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Yes. 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 Hallelujah. Someone else. Someone else. Okay, James. Thank you, James.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. Yeah, that's so important for us to, you know, that as Christians too, we need to pray. You know, pray for those in authority and pray for the upcoming election. You know, because, you know, the thing about Christians is that they can affect the changes in the world if they get prayed. Because the Bible says, if my people, God's people, will humble themselves and pray. That's where it starts. It starts with us. You know, we can affect that change. And sometimes we don't want to do it. We don't get involved. But I'm telling you, that's what makes the difference. When people will pray. Because that God can turn the king's hearts. God can do that. And that's all it's going to take, really, to turn around for us to decide what kind of world do we want. You know, because that makes all the difference. And God's there, man. You know, we have a God that understands the cry of our heart. God don't like ugliness. We often say that a lot in our family. He don't like all the ugliness. You know, people, you know, that the race and all that stuff is an issue. And I said, you know what? We're all part of the human race. Now, I don't care. It don't make no difference what color this person is. We're all part of the human race. The Bible tells me it only started with Adam and Eve. That's who it started with.
Yeah.
So we all descended some. So what we have to look at, I was just sharing this in class. I said, you know, when we look at a human race, there's no people here and some down here.
Right.
You know, and we start looking at each other like this, that changes things right here.
Mm-hmm.
We start looking at, you know what? Everybody would be better off with Jesus in life.
Yeah.
Everybody. Because you can remember, you know, people sometimes I go home and they'll bring up, well, Tim, you used to do this, you used to do that. And I know I said it before, you know, and I'd say that was B.C. You know, that was B.C. That was before Christ. Let's take a look at my life after that. Hadn't always done everything right, but I'm a lot better than I used to be. You know, I'm on the right path. I said, a train, as long as you stay on the rail, it's just going to get where it's going to go. You know, the rail train, that's as far as it's going. But once you get back on the track, we're running. We're going to be going, and we're going to be headed home one day. Hallelujah.
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 Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Hallelujah. And someone else, Mike.
Just thank the Lord to keep our complex here protected from that 5 inches of rain we got yesterday. At least
hallelujah.
I set it on our rain gauge. Went downstairs after work yesterday, came over just to double check on things, and just a little bit of damp over in the northwest corner there, but it cleaned up real nice and easy, and we're good. We're good.
Hallelujah. That's a blessing.
Lord.
Glory. Glory. Glory to God. Get someone else. Praise the Lord. All right. Well, can we stand? And we're going to pray, and then we're going to speak the word, if y'all would stand. Father God, we thank you. Lord, we praise you because you are the mighty God, our wonderful Savior, the one that changed our lives forever. Hallelujah. Your word said, if you be lifted up, draw men unto you. As it says in Esther, who knows whether we come in the kingdom for such a time as this. We're here for a reason, Lord. You have a purpose for our life. Lord, and all the pain and sorrow, you are aware of that. It's not going to be wasted because we're going to come out better than ever. Hallelujah. That people are going to know that we serve you because we're going to start talking like you. We're going to start acting like you. We're going to start believing like you. Oh, Lord, it's just like you just cry out for us to have more faith. Lord, you cry out for us to have more love, more understanding for one another. And it starts here. It all starts inside of us. Lord, we ask you to take out anything inside of us that is not like you. Oh, Lord, we want to ask you to continue to be with Myron's leg, Lord. We know that your word says you are the God that healeth thee. And we're going to claim that. Lord, as you look at the election and the country, if my people, your people, seek yourself, humble themselves, seek you, you would turn this around. And that's what we're going to believe. God, you're mighty. God, it's all about in the beginning, God, you was there. You're still there. You want to commune with us. Lord, we're going to inhabit. Lord, we're going to bring that praise up to you so you come down to us. Because tonight, we are standing on holy ground. Lord, it is all about you. Lord, we just ask you wherever we may go, let us continue to be a light, whether it's at work or home or school, wherever we may be. People will see that we are a reflection of Jesus Christ. Lord, let us be obedient when you feel you put that impression on us to tell this person, I'm praying for you. Let us be obedient and say that. That we can tell this person, you know what, friend, God loves you. God wants to put his arms around you today and tell you there's always a better life in Christ. Oh, Lord, we want to thank you today. Lord, we want to praise you today. Lord, we ask you to be with our pastor and his wife, Lord, and just watch over them as they're apart from us. Watch over for those that could not be here tonight. And we know, Lord, that the heat can create a lot of issues, that you would watch over them. Lord, we thank you that we can come to your house and praise you. We thank you that Lord, we can call upon you and you hear the cry of our hearts. Lord, we want to thank you. We want to praise you. We want to praise you in your wonderful holy name. Amen. Hallelujah and amen. Hallelujah. 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 We're going to go ahead and speak the word. Hallelujah. We're going to speak the word. No cell phones, please. Thank you. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? Hallelujah. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Hallelujah. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body function to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brother Eric, would you come up and take the offering, please? We just got one tonight. So I mean, we got two Erics now. We got two. Would you pray over the offering, please?
All right. to our prayers, listening to our cry to you, Father, and for being here manifested in this place. Yes. Lord, bless every person that is in this building right now.
Yes,
and let your word come forth and provide the fruit that you wanted to produce. In Jesus' name. All right. Praise the Lord. Beautiful day. You can be seated if you're not. Hopefully what I'm going to talk about tonight makes sense to you, or at least you can get something out of it. When Pastor asked me a few weeks ago if I could do this, one, I immediately said yes, because I really like doing this. although I dislike speaking in public in general, this is the only place that I actually feel comfortable doing this. But the first thing that came to my mind when he asked me to do this, I felt that God impressed upon my heart that I was supposed to talk about identity. So as I was thinking about this and trying to figure out what my message for tonight was going to be, I started looking into what identity is. And I found it says that identity is defined as the conception, qualities, beliefs, and expressions that make a person. This is something that we ask ourselves over and over, who am I? Who am I? And this is not something that we are doing just now that we are adults. This is something that we do ever since we are kids, you know? Or people ask us, who are you? Who are you? And usually our response when someone says, who are you, is we say, well, I'm Roberto. You know, you say your name. But the question wasn't, what's your name? The question was, who are you? We wonder who we are. And when we start asking ourselves who we are or who are we start this journey of self-discovery. Because we're trying to figure out who it is that we are. And this is something that we do our entire lives. So some people, they take a test. They start answering all these questions. What do you think of this? What do you think of that? And then based on those questions and the scale that they have, they tell you, well, this is the person that you are. And that's fine, because can be true, but that's only for the physical realm. It's only from the human perspective. But there's another identity that we have, and this other identity is in our spirit. And this identity can only be revealed through the Word of God. So all throughout the Bible, God tells us who we are. And these things that he tells us about who we are things that we have to get a hold of, because we have to understand who we are according to what God says in order to better tap into the supernatural power that we have. So I made a list of things that, in my opinion, are some of the things that tells us about our identity. The first thing that it says in the Bible that we are is that we are created. It's the very first thing that it says. And created, or create, is defined as bring into existence. So Mike, can you go to Genesis 1 verse 1, please? In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. So he brought into existence the heavens and the earth. There was nothing. And he said, this is going to come to existence. Boom. And it happened. Mm-hmm. So he started creating the waters and the plants and the animals and everything. And as Tim said, he saw that it was good. And then he created something else. Verse 26, please. It says, and God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. He created man. He created you. But not only he created you and me, he created us in his image. We were brought into existence by the word that God spoke. Isaiah 43, verse 7. So he created us, but not just because he wanted to create us. It says, even everyone that is called by my name, for I have created him for my glory. Yeah. I have formed him, yea, I have made him. Mm-hmm. So he created us, not just so we could exist. We are an expression of God's glory. Yes. He formed us. He made us. So we're talking not only about our physical form, we're also talking about our spirit. But, you know, when you think about this, he created us, and it doesn't say specifically in there, oh, I created Susanne, I created Tim, I created James, you know. It says, I created you, and some people might say, well, he created Adam and Eve, and then everybody else came from that. And I say, that's true. But creating is not necessarily related to physical things. It also relates to ideas, thoughts, things that cannot be experienced through the senses. And to me, this is the proof that we were created, even though we are not the first men and women on this earth. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5. Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Before any of us was conceived, God had already thought of us. We were already created in God's mind. It is in the moment that we were conceived that we came into existence in a physical form. But our spirit was already thought of before that. Yep. That's how important you are to God, that he created you in his thoughts before you even came into existence into physical form. Yes. The second thing that you are, as part of your identity, you are chosen. Chosen is defined as having been selected as the best, the most appropriate. Isaiah 43, verse 10. You are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God form, neither shall there be after me. I believe every single person on the face of this earth has been chosen. There's a difference, though. Some know it, some don't. Some want to acknowledge that they're chosen, others choose not to. So I don't want you to misunderstand me when I'm talking about this, that we specifically are better than other people because we were chosen. Everyone is chosen. It's up to us to acknowledge that we have been chosen.
Glory.
First Peter chapter 2, verse 9. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light.
Yes.
After the fall, darkness came on this earth. And there was only one way that that darkness was going to be cast out. That's when Jesus came. And God sent them for him to be the light of the world, to cast out all that darkness. And everything was fulfilled when he said on the cross, "It is finished." It's at that moment that the law and the prophets were fulfilled. And we had access to God like we didn't have before. You have been selected by God to carry out his will and purpose on this earth. I believe that us, as the body of Christ, all have a common purpose to fulfill on this earth under his divine plan. You know, we're all supposed to go out and talk to the nation, preach the gospel, share the good news with people. Mm-hmm. We ought to pray for others. We have to show them who God is.
Yes.
That is a common purpose that all in the body of Christ have.
Yes.
But there's also individual purposes that each one of us has that are unique that we have to fulfill as well. That is, even though we are one body, we are all the same in God's eyes, that individual purpose that we all have is what makes us unique,
mm-hmm.
even though we're all the same.
Mm-hmm.
As part of your identity with God, you are also his child. John 1, verse 12. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. He says that you receive him. When you receive him, you are given the right to become a child of God. In order to receive him, you have to let him in, like Eric said a few weeks ago. You have to let him in. You have to call him. He's going to come into your life either by you calling him or you answering his call. You know, this is going to sound funny, but Jesus is like what the Jehovah's Witness do, going door to door at 6 in the morning. Hello, good morning. I have a funny story about that with my brother, but that's a story for another day. So he's going door to door, knocking. 6 in the morning, 5 in the morning, 7. In Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, it talks about this. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me.
Yes.
So he's knocking on the door. Sometimes we don't hear that. So when he went to the neighbor, all of a sudden we need him, God, and we call him, and he comes back. I'm here. Open the door. So he's calling us all the time, but we don't call him all the time. Regardless of this, he's going to come the same way, whether he calls us and we answer, or we call him and he answers, and we receive him into our lives. He's waiting for us with open arms, ready to receive us. You know, this reminds me of of the story of the prodigal son, you know, and that's how parents are. And it's very interesting, because when we're adults, we start looking back into our lives, and all of those things that we're seeing here now that we understand, we start seeing all the times that our parents did it for us when we were kids, mm-hmm. but either we didn't acknowledge it or we were annoyed by it. Mm-hmm. Come here, my child, let me love you and hug you and kiss you. My mom used to do that. And sometimes, I didn't say much, but sometimes I was like, okay. And I think we've all done that before. And that's just part of being an adolescent or a child. The whole lovey-dovey thing, it gets a little bit annoying. But when you think about that now, you're like, man, how blessed was I that I had a mother or a father that did that for me every day. And that's what God's doing. That's what we are, his children, because that's what parents do for his kids. Galatians chapter 3, verse 26. For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. So Jesus came. He died for us, and because of that, all the prophecies were fulfilled. The law was fulfilled. Now we have this access to God that we didn't have before. But we need to have faith in him. Now, I think that's something that is harder for us in this day and age to do than it was for the apostles, because they actually saw it. And when you see something, it's easier for you to believe in it, because you actually experience it with your physical senses. Regardless, when you do have faith in him, it is because of that faith that you are now a son of God. And the last thing that I want to talk about today that I believe is part of your identity in God is that you are redeemed. Redemption is defined as the action of being saved from sin, error, or evil. Again, Jesus came to this earth to die for our sins. When he died, everything was finished. The law and the prophets were fulfilled. As a result of this, our salvation became obtainable. And when we are saved, we are redeemed. What does the Bible say about being saved? It says that all of those that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Yep. It also says in Romans that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Amen. Everything hangs upon that particular event, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. That is the last piece of the puzzle, basically. And now the whole picture is revealed, and we can see everything clearly. Or at least we attempt to. Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 and 14. Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins.
Yes.
Darkness was upon the land, and he came to get us away from that darkness. He is the light of the world. He came, he brought light, he paid the ultimate price, spilled his blood, and now we are redeemed.
Yes.
you're created, you're chosen, you're now his child, and you're redeemed. Think about this. Meditate on it. Ask the Lord to embed those things in your heart. Father, I know that I am your creation. I know that you chose me.
Yes.
Because I am your child and I am redeemed. Oh, man. Father, I know that I am created, that I am chosen because I am your child, and I am redeemed. That's my message.